I think we can wait for maybe 2 minutes, 3 minutes before we start the introduction and things.
So should we start, folks? I think we have reached 6 p.m. and Tao, would you monitor the waiting room to let people?
Yeah, I will do that. I'll handle this for you.
I can also help.
Okay, so let's get started. I think let me start the recording. We're also live on YouTube. Okay, thank you. Thank you all for being this, being here. This is the first One World Signal Processing Seminar for the fourth season. And it is our greatest pleasure to have Professor Giannakis from University of Minnesota to kick off the season. And I see a lot of colleagues here. I think under this very trying time, it is still a pleasure to see everybody here. So let me introduce you a little bit about our logistics, how we are going to run this seminar today, this virtual seminar today. So we will first, so later I will be letting my good colleague Yan Ning to introduce our speaker today. And then the talk will take about 15 minutes. So because of this special form, we would like to ask everybody to hold their questions during the talk so that the speaker will not be interrupted. So if you really have some questions that you think you want us to relate to the speaker, you could send it through chat. So the organizers here, we have five organizers here. We will be closely monitoring the chat box and record your questions. And after that, we will have 10-15 minutes Q&A session. So then we could communicate with the speaker. So that's basically the idea. And I see we have more than 100 people here. So people would come in. So you could also let your friends and colleagues know that if we have reached the limit of this Zoom room, which is 300, we also have this YouTube streaming that is live. Even after the talk, we will be uploading the recording of this talk to YouTube, so you can always come back and check out the talk. Okay, and if you haven't subscribed, please come to our website and subscribe. We will be sending you emails, reminders regarding the upcoming talks, the speakers, the title, abstract, etc., all relevant information, right? And to keep you updated. Okay, so I'll just pass the microphone to my good colleague Yan Ning at the University of California, Irvine. So she's gonna introduce our speaker today.
Okay, thank you, Xiao. I'm Yan Ning Shen from University of California, Irvine. Today is my great honor to introduce our first speaker, Professor Giannakis from University of Minnesota, who is also my PhD advisor. And he holds a chair in wireless communications, a University of Minnesota McKnight Presidential Chair in ECE, and serves as director of the Digital Technology Center. He has published more than 470 journal papers, 770 conference papers, and 25 book chapters, two books, and two research monographs. He is inventor of 34 issued patents and the co-receipt of 9 Best Journal Paper Awards from the IEEE Signal Processing and Communication Societies. He also received the IEEE SPS Norbert Wiener Society Award, Tech Achievement Award from the IEEE SPS and from EuroSIP, the IEEE Comms Society Education Award, and the IEEE for Real Technical Field Award. He is a foreign member of the Academia Europea, fellow of the National Academy of Inventors and the European Academy of Sciences. In addition, he has advised 52 PhDs in the last 28 years, including myself. 30 out of 52 become faculty members, and 12 out of 52 become IEEE fellows. And he also mentored 25 postdocs, from which 16 are now faculty members and 10 are now IEEE fellows. I was very honored to become one of his students, and I wish I could become as good a researcher and advisor as he is. So let's welcome Professor Giannakis to give us his talk about adaptive diffusions for scalable and robust learning over graphs.
Thank you so much, Yanning. Welcome everyone to this first OWSP seminar for this academic year. And let me also take this opportunity to thank the organizers for the invitation and the diligent effort they put in coordinating this seminar series. In addition, I want to acknowledge the National Science Foundation sources, but thank especially the gentlemen that you see there, now Dr. Berberidis and Dr. Nikolakopoulos, that deserve most of the credit for the research I will touch upon in this seminar. Dimitri is now with Goldman Sachs, and Thanos is with as a research associate at the University of Minnesota. All right, so the title has the word graphs, so I don't need to motivate that much the fact that graph representations appear in several applications, whether they model real networks, meaning, for example, the transportation network down here, where the links are physical streets, or capturing or being built based on similarities or dissimilarities of nodal vectors that reside on the vertices. So the objective for today's talk, high level, is to learn the values of labels or values of nodes from a subset. So we have a subset of nodes, we know their labels. For example, in citation networks, where nodes could be papers, links could be papers that cross-cited and labels are conferences to be submitted or topics to be assigned to, and or image segmentation, for example. And you are trying to extrapolate, learn the labels everywhere. So what are the challenges? This graphs can be huge in the orders of hundreds of thousands or million when you talk about social networks, for example. And labeling or knowing values of different nodes is a scarce phenomenon, because you may have privacy considerations, you may have cost of battery, or if you go crowdsourcing, you may have unreliable human annotators. So let me try to formalize the problem a little bit. You are given a graph, vertices or nodes V, edges calligraphic E. Well, suppose we have a adjacency matrix which is weighted and non-negative here, or zero, and labels per node VI or vertex. As I said already, you know W, or you can identify it. For example, if you have nodal vectors, you can take the normalized cross-correlation coefficients in absolute value, and if they're above a threshold, you assign that value, or if they're below, you assign them to zero, for example. And the goal is, if you are given the labels that I collect in a calligraphic L set, which is a subset of all vertices, right? You're given labels on calligraphic L. And you are also given the graph, meaning the weighted adjacency. You want to infer the labels of unlabeled nodes that, since they are unlabeled, I denote it as U, which is V minus L. Suppose you have a criterion and you have a finite alphabet of your classes. If you want to be optimum, You have to try all combinations, which is combinatorially complex, and therefore it'll be hard. So the problem is interesting and challenging. People have pursued this in the last 3, 4 decades. And I grouped the approaches in three categories. The first is the transductive semi-supervised learning, which is a non-parametric approach that propagates the labels utilizing the graph. Okay. The representative is the k nearest neighbor rule. You have some of them, and a new one, you basically take a majority vote to give it the class that most of its neighbors, you know, share. So, however, they are not adaptive to classes. They do the same thing everywhere. The other class of methods is referred to as node embedding, and they have this interesting names, nodes to vec, planetoid, deep walk. So basically what you do, for example, using multidimensional scaling, you start from the graph, you generate vectors that have approximate distances given by the edges of the graph, and then you proceed with learning as if you have vectors. So you forget altogether the graph. The challenge there is that these do not scale well, because you need eigen decompositions as big as, you know, especially when you have many labeled nodes. But also, who tells you the correct embedding dimension? Two dimensional is good, three dimensional, five, 10, whatever. So that is not clear. And the last one is a parametric generative approach that relies on graph convolutional networks. I write the first two that I read from 2016, and there are three dots that says this field is a popular one. And you may want to look at references on this tutorial that I cite at the bottom. Over there, the challenge is that you have a black box approach that cannot rule over fitting. It tends to be computationally heavy, as we will see clearly. Now, with this background, I can tell you what is our approach. Our approach relies on random walks on graphs. And I will start the intuition for the method and the idea from a Greek proverb. We say in Greek, tell me your friends to tell you who you are. So the intuition is translated as an unlabeled node that is strongly interconnected and thus influenced by labeled nodes of a class, it is likely to belong to this class. Okay, there's an English proverb as well that I'll give you a hint toward the end of the talk where it comes from. So the English proverb reads like this. Birds of a feather flock together. The feather here is of a similar taste they are collecting. So what is the suggestion here? It suggests that we model these influences or the infections, if you want to think more along the lines of COVID, influences are modeled by k-hop paths that follow k-step random walks. So you may be influenced by your first, the single hop neighbor, your significant other or close friend or relative three, four hops down the road. That's the key point. So the position xk minus one of a weak walker at hop k minus one resides on node A with this probability P sub J sub K minus one, which is the probability of this random variable, which is a position, to be equal to J. So you have a certain probability of being infected, right? And then you have a certain probability of being transmitting your infection through transition probability, which basically is the conditional XK to be on node I at the K step given J. And here is where the graph comes into picture. We model those conditionals, those transition probabilities, as the ratio of Wij over Dj. And we divide DJ is the degree of node J. And clearly, this is less than one. So this resides between 0 and 1. And I will call this Aij for the adjacency. Very good. So if I am at k minus 1, xk minus 1 equals j, using the theorem of total probability, I can find out, using as weights, the conditionals, where that what's the probability of me to reside at k. This is just the theorem of total probability. You either go through, you either were at j, 1, j2, j3 in the node in order to be infected, to have a probability of being infected while sitting at I. Okay, so now let's take all these probabilities across all nodes and stack them in a column vector P, sub K. Clearly, since this conditional is Aij, it's not difficult to verify that this is like multiplying the PK minus one by A. And if you use induction and you have started by a P0, this is just A to the K times P0. So what's the moral of the story? If you give me P0, you start from a given P0, and you give me the graph through A, I can tell you how the influence of P0 propagates. So basically, if you view the label of every class as a virus, then you will be a virus has infected a node after k steps while it has started from a spreader of node of the same label at P0. Okay, so our next step is to go from landing probabilities to classification. And if you want to do classification, you know, we know that you have to go through the class probability mass functions. And for every n, this is f, I is the ith entry of the probability that I have landed at I. Okay? So the key idea here is to model these PMF vectors for every class C. And of course, if I take the maximum, I will tell you how to extrapolate, what is the winner class, using the landing PMFs. And now let's repeat what we saw earlier with the subscript C, which is different for every class. We have already seen that. And let's specify if L sub C is the set of labeled nodes from class C as a vector, that all the nodes from class C that are labeled take this uniform weight and the rest are zero, okay? So we start from this root PMF. And after using these powers of A that is sparse and therefore is easy to compute, we can form these landing probabilities. So how those relate to the FC? We sit and say the following. There is a probability that I have been infected after one step, and this is a theta one. There is a probability that I have been infected after two or after capital K. And let's suppose that K is given. So this basically says that this FC theta is a matrix PCK that contains all the landing probabilities for different number of hops. And theta, to interpret it as a probability, we force it to lie on the K dimensional simplex, okay? So basically theta K tells you what is the probability, if k, little k is three, what is the probability that you have been infected by a three hop spreader? All right. And what is nice about this model of the for classification is that it subsumes known members of the diffusion family. So for example, if the theta follows a geometric progression, mu k, and you have a 1 minus mu with appropriate normalization, you retrieve the so-called personalized page rank diffusion. This is basically a 1 minus mu incidentally refers to, for those of you that are familiar with walks, the restart probability. A second special case is the heat kernel diffusion that basically views the infection as heat flowing from the root nodes to the rest of the nodes of the network after time t. And it uses this exponential and this polynomial of degree capital K. What is important to stress here is the following. Both of these special cases have fixed parameters, t and mu. One parameter each, and that limits their degrees of freedom. In contrast, we have the freedom of having theta 1, theta capital K. And this is precisely our key contribution. It's twofold. We have a graph adaptive selection of theta, but also a label adaptive selection of theta. Okay, how do we select theta? That's the question now. We have a parametric approach per se, okay, to specify this capital F. Remember, if you give me capital F, for every entry, I will see across all classes which one is the largest, and I will assign my my node to this particular winning class. So knowing the theta implies you can find the capital FC per class. Okay. How do we find theta? That's the question. This is the word adapting the diffusion, adaptive diffusions. So we will adapt it for each class differently. So we will introduce a loss function and a regularizer. The loss will rely on labeled nodes. So this YLC is an indicator function that has non-zeros only when you are on locations of labeled nodes with a class C, okay? So basically this quadratic form that takes into account also the degree is trying to say that since I have the labeled nodes, I know this LC, right? Then I want my F to correctly reveal the labeled nodes, right? But also I want to extrapolate, and the extrapolation happens through the regularizer that basically calls for a smooth transition of F across the graph through the weighted Laplacian of the graph. And I stress, we are here on the unlabeled nodes, okay? But remember that I model FC using a parameter theta. So this one I'm not going to solve because it has dimension as large. It does not scale well. It has dimension as large as the network size. So it can be hundreds or thousands, okay? Instead, I am gonna go after theta because the dimension of theta is K. That is up to me to select how much complexity I can afford. And what we really call adaptive diffusions is nothing but substituting this parametric form in this F and then ending up with a linear quadratic program over theta. And I say program because I remind you, theta belongs to a simplex. The good news is that this capital BC and vector BC are computable through the landing probabilities in a very efficient manner, thanks to the sparsity that I talked about. And this is what justifies this differential landing probability that you can see in the paper. Which paper? The one that contains also this beautiful figure that summarizes what I discussed so far. Suppose I have a graph, small graph here. Suppose I have two red nodes that are labeled red and two green nodes that are labeled green and I know them. The light blue ones, I don't know where they are. And because in soccer, there are reds against greens, then I support the reds. And then we want to decide the ones that are connected with me, are they likely to be my Olympiacos supporters? But before we decide that, here is what ADADIF does. it multiplies this P red, P sub bar is for the red, right? Remember, I had P sub C. This is the red here. And out of all the nodes I have here, only these two red entries will be non-zero, right? And then successively, I multiply so that I propagate the infection, okay? If I multiply once with A, propagate it once, twice, third, three, and so on. What graphical signal processing people like to call graph filtering. So this is after K, and I collect all of this. And I do the same thing with the greens. The moment I have the PR, the landing probabilities, I can formulate and solve my quadratic program and give you back a theta for the reds and a theta for the greens. And if I know the theta, then directly I multiply by my landing probability matrix after capital K, and here you go with F red. This is plus PMFs. So if I want to see this node, whether it's red or green, then I'm sitting here and I'm saying, okay, if this is the first entry of the F, is the entry red greater than the entry green, then it's red, otherwise green. So this is the maximum likelihood classifier, all right? Let me go and interpret these ideas a little bit more. It's helpful to go to extremes sometimes. So let us. This is the cost function I was trying to optimize over theta. If you ignore the loss of the testing data, of the labeled data, and you rely only on the R, then as lambda grows, you tend to concentrate on the last landing probabilities. You tend to forget where you started because you say smooth, smooth, smooth. Okay, let me. When on the other hand, lambda goes to zero, that means you focus on the feeding, then you concentrate on the first few landing probabilities, which is intuitively reasonable since very short walks likely visit similar labeled nodes, okay? Now, the diff really targets a sweet spot between these two extremes. And because the theta resides on a simplex, that means it is non-zero, non-negative, I'm sorry, then this regularizer promotes sparsity of theta as well. And here it's like, if you look at theta versus the K hops, right? So I'm plotting here the hit kernel, the personalized page rank, and the additive. You see the interesting thing with additive, it takes into account both neighbors as well as other higher hop values, whereas it promotes sparsity, many of them are zero. What is even more interesting is that if K is, that you select, is less than the number of edges over the size of the network, then you have a linear complexity, which is, this is the manifestation of the sparsity of the adjacency. This is true for non-adaptive hit kernel and PPR, and it's also true that all of them can operate in parallel. Since you have per class, you do the same thing. And why is this important? Do you know what made Google what it is known for? It is this PPR and the low complexity. When someone tells you Google it, you want to come back and figure out the correct entries to your query. So the only thing is to avoid a large K. But if you worry even more, you can have smaller case, you can instead take a dictionary of theta vectors or different diffusions, I meant to say, either the theta PPR, the personalized page rank, or the theta HK, the hit kernel, or anything else you like, put them in a vector and in a column matrix, and then postulate the theta is C times that. And that way, you can, even when k is greater than the number of edges over n, then again, the complexity grows linearly over k plus t. And if you don't want to carry out the quadratic program, if you remove the relaxed simplex constraints on theta, then the linear quadratic problem can be solved in closed form, right? We know that. And this is what it is. However, what is critical is that I have not addressed yet. What is the right capital K? How far do I go? If I go too far, I may not be able to afford it computationally. I may forget where I started from if I go too far. So, but if I go too close, then I may not have the chance to explore the space. So we were motivated by that to establish a bound on K. And this bound has a subscript gamma that depends on how distinguishable are the two classes. If the two classes are too easy to distinguish, that's much easier. The K should stay within each class, right? But if they are mixed, then it's more challenging. And this bound depends on quantities of the graph, such as here we have two classes, the plus and the minus. So it depends on the minimum degree and the maximum degree of each class, as well as on the eigenvalues of the normalized graph Laplacian. Take home message. Don't take K too large, because in addition to complexity, you run the problem over parameterization that I already mentioned. In our practical setup that we tried several real data sets, anything between 30 and 40 for sample nodes as little as 10% or even less, and for separable classes, sufficiently separable classes is typically perfectly fine. So I told you how ADDIF works and what are the merits of it, right? It's a parametric, it has low complexity. But I mentioned at some point that it may remind you of graph filters. And so you may ask, what is different? Well, there are several things that are different. There are different losses and regularizers, including those that I will talk about, the outlier resilience. The other thing is, this is only for two classes, what has been used, we use adaptive filters, and where ADDIF can take care of multi-class labels as well. The other major thing is that we enjoy reduced complexity and we reduce the search space. And we have a way to find at least an upper bound on K. Now, I talked also about graph neural networks, right? And here I have the 16 and I have a 19 from friends and colleagues, one of the heavily cited papers, and I gave you another tutorial if you want. What is the issue in the advantage, the upshot of ADDIF is that it involves a small number of constrained parameters. Therefore, it is less prone to overfitting. It's simpler, it can be parallelizable per class and does not require backpropagation to train. And more important, graph convolutional networks, if you give them only the network or the graph, they have tough challenges because they better use the nodal feature vectors. This is not needed for us, even if we don't have, then we can extrapolate, as you saw, through the graph only. But if you have, we can incorporate it, because as I told you at the beginning, when you have nodal vectors, you can take the coordination coefficient and build a graph. So instead of one regularizer, you can have two regularizers. And you can have multi-layer graphs as well. Time for some simulations. Real data sets throughout. I have these graphs here. They have nodes as many as 3,000 or as 10,000 nodes and hundreds of thousands of edges. And you can have as many as 30, 50, 40 or 50 classes. and multi-labels. The typical thing is the F1 score that relates the true positive, the true false negative, and false positive. And there are two versions of this that come across through averaging. I don't want to get into the details. It's a standard figure of merit. I want to say that the micro F1 score, it can be influenced when you have classes of large size. Whereas the macro, to get a high performance, you need to have a good performance for classes that even have small size. Okay? So here I'm testing the equally fast personalized page rank and hit kernel using k equals 30 higher than us, and additive with 15. And here I'm showing the macro F1 versus the landing probability capital K. And you see that the red, the higher the better, right? The red is the additive. Now, if you go to the multi-class, we have micro F1 and macro F1, remember. Here, this is the ratio additive of the labeled nodes over the entire number of nodes. Here I have only 2.5%. And in the PubMed, we have even less than 1% of the nodes that are labeled, okay? And then look at how additive compares. This is the highlighted line, which is always higher in its numbers, how it compares with node embedding approaches and graph convolutional networks. And the same for the macro. Even for multi-label graphs, again, we do comparably on the micro, but we do much better on the macro. So regardless of how small or high, how large are the classes, we outperform the state of the art. And this is just the small advantage of additive. Additive thrives when you start talking about runtime. If you look at relative runtime of additive and node embedding and graph convolutional networks, Cora, Dataset, Sightseer, PubMed, okay? Hundreds of thousands of nodes. The additive here, the smaller the better. Additive is the red. Look at all the competition, goes up 2 or 3 orders of magnitude more complex. Now, the title promised something about robustness. So even if there are people or some of the labeled nodes are being infected, we can work our objective function to accommodate such cases. So basically what we do here is the following. We form a loss function that isolates every node that is labeled and is trying to predict it with all other nodes. Okay? So you can guess that if there is an outlier, this residual, or one of the residuals, because I'm looking at all labeled nodes, one of the residuals at least will be high. So the key idea is build a function that whenever you have outliers, pumps up with high residuals. And that's what is explained here. You don't need to go through the details. But then we basically use this objective function and use an outlier vector O sub C per class C, and O stands for the outliers, and the non-zero entries of this O that we reveal from the optimization problem are where the outliers reside. And once we know where the outliers reside and what is the right theta that we can do the combination, we identify the outliers, we remove them, and then predict the unlabeled ones as before. Here is performance with anomalies, macro F1 score, label corruption with the probability pi of probability of corruption. That means if you have a label C, artificially we flip it uniformly to another label, and then we see how we do. What you see here, the R is robust additive, and it is the yellow line that stays above. That means it's more robust than the red, which I presented earlier, and the competition, which is personalized page rank and hit kernel. Okay. Likewise for the macro F1 score. And we are used to ROC curves. Here is indeed the probability of detection, which basically tells you that you can detect correctly, sufficiently correctly the outliers. And as expected, your performance is improving. You are closer to the one mean as the probability of corruption decreases. All right? So I discussed, let's take a breather to see where we are. I argued that even if you think along COVID, along the lines of COVID, that can occur through spreading of hops, of variable hops, right? Either first one hop neighbors or multi-hop. If you draw these ideas and you formulate and leverage the state of the art in random walks, or the fundamentals or basics of, in this particular case, of random walks, then you can come up with a way of extrapolating a limited knowledge that resides on graph. But there was a tacit assumption here that I have one graph, and it's unclear whether I can look for additional graphs or different graphs, whether I can claim more things. And it's interesting that if you start thinking, what about bipartite graphs? Can I play similar tricks in bipartite graphs? And then you can start reflecting, what is the usefulness of a bipartite graph? A bipartite graph is emerging readily in, for example, recommender systems or link prediction problems. So how likely is to connect an item with a user is like how likely is to have an edge in this graph. So that's why, do I predict that there is a connectivity there or not? And so the rest of the slides will focus on using random walks for top R recommendations, what Google says. Give me the top 10 items that I would like, or movies. So high level description. You are given U users, capital U. By the way, this U from now on is whatever was the number of classes before. I items. And you have a U by I, user item interaction metrics or rating metrics, right? Which clearly has many unknown entries, since since every user buys a limited number of products and each product is bought by a limited number of users. So after you give me this B, okay, I want you to give me back a recommendation or PMF vector P sub U. And if I rank order the entries of P sub U, I'm going to tell you the higher ones that are the most likely for you to buy. You are a user. Here is the idea. The ratings that we place on products are intimately related with item-item graph connectivity, okay? So if two items, suppose you have bought a coffee machine, right? Then it's very likely that in the graph of items, if in this item, which is called coffee machine, you have the filters and you have the coffee and so on and so forth. Okay? So here is what we do. We say the rating of item I, B, I, U, the rating of item I by user U is a linear combination of other items, J, that the same user bought. And this AIJ is not accidentally AIJ. It's because it's going to be nothing but the strength or the item-item graph adjacency metric, the entries of the adjacency metrics. So if we take this linear equation plus noise to model our model dynamics, and we stack one under the other to form this, other users are available as well, then per item I have a linear system of equations. And I know how to solve that in many different ways. The modern one is to use an elastic net so that you postulate that A, the adjacency per column I, right, has many zeros, right? And then it's smooth, so the elastic net is natural. So again, your adjacency matrix is sparse. And when you have knowledge of the A, then you can use this linear equation in the reverse direction. So you can leverage the B's that you know and mingle them with A's to predict what you don't have. And this is exactly what we do. We normalize predicted ratings and recommend the ith item with probability PUI. And what is this PU? Is the inner product of A with the B, the A that we estimated here, okay? We normalize by this to make sure that we have a probability there, right? So, and if you select the top R, then you have the top 10 items that you may want to buy, okay? So that's something that was actually in the context of recommender systems was recognized by one of my colleagues and his group in that reference down here. However, there is a motivation of going beyond interactions, single hop interactions, to broaden the item space coverage. Because as we said, you are basically sparse. You don't have too many B's, so you can go too far. You cannot go too far in your inference. So one idea is to start with the BU that you have, which you normalize so that it can be a probability, that can be an initial condition. And pretty much like before, do K steps, either the way we selected it with ADDIF or with personalized page rank. But even that one, if you look at it and think more for this recommender system problem, because you have two different graphs here, the item graph and the user graph, then this vector, PMF vector that we were gonna use to do classification, depends on you, and the initial depends on you, but the AK does not depend on you. And this means, in plain English, that we would love to have users that explore the item space differently. So the different users start from different items. That's why this is the initial, the root PMF. But they also explore. Some of them are more impulsive, right? They buy many things together. So we want to have a per user transition probability. So a better idea is to use personalized exploration. And that's why we call it per diff instead of other diff. So personalized diffusion. So again, we start with a random Walker U. The Walker holds capital K biased coins, either follows A with a probability mu U1, or it restarts. So in order to, this is very critical with probability one minus mu U, right? So notice that we do something different in every step of the process, infection process, and mu UK and one minus mu UK. But we repeat that as before, and now we don't have A to the K, but we have products of these graph matrices, okay? You can call them modified adjacency matrices. But these modified adjacency matrices, they have some parameters there, the mu's. And these parameters can be learned pretty much as we did before. I will speed up a little bit. Basically, again, you start with items that are rated by user U. These are red and blue, and isolate one of them, let's say the blue, and you are trying to predict it with the red, okay? And the yellows, which are the unrated, not only the rated, which are the red, but the unrated, which are the yellow. And then you are saying, because I'm not taking all the graph, I'm using a subset of the graph, I'm selecting some nodes so that I can have manageable complexity, then I'm gonna form this optimization problem. So I have a target vector HQ that has an entry 1 if it is labeled and 0 if it's unlabeled. And then I do this quadratic matching. So I am solving over M tilde U is the optimization variables from 1 up to K. I minimize this fit. The problem is that already you may have noticed is a multiplication. So yeah, this problem is non-convex, severely non-convex. But you can surrogate it to a convex problem as follows. You can collect judiciously this MU parameters and solve a convex surrogate of phi of mu U. And surprise, surprise, this phi of mu U and the K plus one step now probability landing matrix, landing probability matrix, is basically a linear, yields a linear function, and linear is linear. So you have a quadratic problem and then you can solve it in closed form or easily, even if you impose the simplex. But you can find the phi and then you can go back and find the mu. So in summary, you are given the interactions pretty much as I described earlier, column by column in parallel to save computations, you solve a sparse regression problem to identify the adjacency matrix, the graph of the item-item matrix associated with it. Then you rely on a modified transition matrix that involves what is similar but distinct per user, K plus one landing probability matrices, and then you solve a convex surrogate, which is easier to solve. That is a function of mu U, the unknown parameters that define your diffusions. And then use backward substitution to obtain the mu U in complexity of order K. And finally, after capital K steps, you can multiply all the G's, right? Each little K is solved using the corresponding mu U, is obtained with the corresponding mu U, and then you multiply up to capital K, and you find the per step and per the per user probability mass function. How well does it do? There is a metric in popular metric in recommended systems that is called normalized discounted collective gain. I'm not going to tell you what it is. The higher, the better. The green is per diff, personalized diffusion. The competition is the rest. We are about 2 times better. And these are the standard baseline state of the art. Now, the most impressive again comes on the runtimes. And let me ask you to focus on the Netflix that has almost 500,000 users here, this data set, and about 18,000 users. That's a sizable data set. It took us 87 minutes to find this adjacency matrix, minutes, M for minutes. But look at what's happening here. How much, once you know the A, how much I'm gonna return to you, the recommender systems. You saw it right, is less than 1 millisecond. This is the per user fit. This is the power of personalized diffusions. And this brings me to the current recent directions. I'll tell you what I promised at the beginning. So one thing to remember from this talk is that this guy Giannakis started from an English proverb, which says, once again, birds of the same of a feather flock together. That means birds of a similar taste congregate. And then when I searched to make sure whether it's a British one, I realized, no, it's an ancient Greek one. Plato said it first time in the Republic. So that's what I relied on. I'm happy that of that coincidence. And we can investigate different losses and diverse regularizers. I already mentioned that. We can boost accuracy if we have nonlinear diffusion models and explore means for reducing complexity even further. And these days we're looking at online ada diff and per diff, but for dynamic graphs. On this note, thank you. And you know, I'm glad to try and address questions. Thank you.
Thank you for the nice talk. I think there's a question from the audience that I will relay, which says that spectral-based random walks tend to over-diffuse. Have you considered nonlinear diffusions where the random walk matrix changes at each iteration to capture important edges?
Yeah, this is. I'm not sure if that is covered by the dynamic graphs, right? So basically, and also this is covered by the what we did in the per diff, right? Over here, for example, you see at every step, we're using a different graph, right? A different restart probability or mu u type of constant. So that renders the adjacency different from step to step. Did I answer the question?
I think so. Yeah, if there's any additional, any other questions from the audience?
Yeah, perhaps you could, if you have questions, you could unmute yourself.
And, sure. Yeah, you can pose them at this point. Think about it. As I said, the talk here is based, I should have written it somewhere, right? I have. Yeah, that's the paper that I cited. It was published about a year ago on the first part of ada diff. Basically utilizes for semi-supervised learning the adaptive diffusions. The other one was published last year also in the flagship conference of flagship conference of recommended systems, or REXIS. That's an international conference about a year from now. So,
yeah, for the sake of time, we can take perhaps one or two questions. I see Ching is asking.
Yes, Ching.
So Ching is asking, any hints to design effective nonlinear diffusion rules?
Oh, well, one approach could be to take we are a little bit, I want to mention one more thing. We have what I mentioned as a future direction to take nonlinear diffusions is basically here. I only have the theta case, right? And conceivably one could consider a Volterra type, right? And that could be a nonlinear thing. However, I want to mention that the very fact that we're considering capital K steps and we are multiplying things, then the diffusion is somewhat nonlinear, right? Basically, if you go from 0 to 1, you have linear. And then you don't go from 1 to 2, you again have linear. But from 0 to 2, you are not following linearity, right? But as I said, the alternative would have been to take this theta k and try another term, which is theta k prime k double prime, which is like the second order Volterra, and then take inner products of this PMF vectors. By the way, the Volterra approach on a different context, but related, was in a paper that we presented with the group, my group, and the group of Professor Luz. Mario Coutinho was the first author in ICAS 2020. That never happened, but you can find it in the proceedings. If you search for Mario Coutinho, Cara Nicolas is the student from our group in Minnesota, and my name then, and Luz, you should be able to find it. So that has a possible nonlinear diffusion for semi-supervised learning.
Okay, thank you. I think there are two additional questions. One is from Tall. He asks, for ADA diff, is it possible to design some kind of a moving average in time filter to accelerate the convergence of diffusion?
Say it again, the time average, say it again.
Is it possible to design some kind of moving average in time filter to accelerate the convergence of diffusion?
Well, if you have a time series, then that would be a very reasonable thing. And another student of Yert, Isufi, was thinking along these lines in filtering. But this somehow presumes, if I understood correctly, that you have a temporal component or temporal graphs. That could be of interest for sure. Then you can accelerate that. Yeah, that's a good suggestion. We have not looked at it.
Yeah, I think it might be very interesting to look at the convergence rate. And there's another question that is that you are only utilizing the graph. What do you think about the mixture of graphs and features of nodes that is trending nowadays?
Yeah, I said it actually, but I said it rather too fast, I guess. I'll repeat it. Look at what is the key slide, right? So remember, we have a loss function where we're trying to match F with the labels. And we have a regularizer. Over here, we are just utilize the graph through its Laplacian and its degree matrices, right? So you see that this regularizer has nothing to do with, it has only to do with the graph. But think about the following approach. If you give me nodal vectors or features, I can tell you, I can take the inner product of pairs and form the, normalize them and form a correlation coefficient. If the correlation coefficient is above a threshold, I give as Aij, as Wij, this value. Otherwise, if it is too low or negative, for example, I can set it to zero. Okay? So I created a graph from the nodal vectors. This is the opposite way from node embedding. If you have node embed, if you have a graph, you can do node embedding. But if you have vectors, if you have vectors, you can find a graph, right? It goes both ways. So once you have another graph, I use another regularizer. For me, you can always interpret, vectors as graphs. And that's much easier using what I told you than going the other way around. From graphs to vectors, multidimensional scaling entails eigendecompositions, right? So you see what I'm saying? Here, instead of having lambda times r, we're going to have lambda 1 times r1 plus lambda 2 times r2 for the second graph, right? That will have a different Laplacian, L2, right? And I can do as many graphs as you want, as many.
Yeah.
So in a way, the graphs are created by vectors that live on them.
I see. Yeah, I guess as you said that in cases where there are also feature vectors, they can you can actually use the feature vectors to create different graphs, and you may even be able to create different graphs based on different criterions that capture different correlations among feature vectors, right?
So, exactly, exactly. And also you can have even, you may belong to multiple graphs, like you have a connection in LinkedIn and you have a connection in WeChat, right? With whom you are connected. You see what I'm saying? You can have even multi-layer graphs.
Yes, yes. Gives
not you only one graph.
Mm-hmm. I see. Yeah, so for the sake of time, we will not accept more questions. If you have any additional questions, please feel free to send emails to Professor Giannakis or send it to us that we will try to relay. Thank you again for everyone for attending the talk today. And thank you, Professor Giannakis, for your time and nice talk. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Just a reminder, we will be having our next talk on next Thursday, the same time. Our next speaker is Professor Wahid Bajawa from the Rutgers University. We'll be talking about some interesting things about the tensor and the dictionary learning. So stay tuned.
He is also here now.
Yeah, I think Wahid is here. So we will be sending you reminders.
Hi, everyone. Hope to see everyone next week.